So welcome to another episode of the Marketer's Edge, a series designed to share senior level marketing perspective about marketer challenges, opportunities, and agency relationships. Our goal is to help marketers and agencies learn from other marketers across different industries. And today we're talking with Doug Bastian, the National Sales and Marketing Manager at Alforex Seeds, based in Woodland, California. Doug, thanks so much for joining us today. How have you been?
I've been doing great. Thank you for asking.
That's great. Yeah, I was really looking forward to today's interview. We haven't interviewed anybody in sort of the space that you operate in, so was really looking forward to the conversation. And I've got a small handful of questions for you, but before we get to those questions, can you tell me a little bit about Alforex Seeds, and what you do for the organization? I'd like our audience to know what kind of company it is and what you do for them.
Sure. So Alforex Seeds stands for Alfalfa and Forage Excellence. So we are part of Corteva Agriscience, and we focus our energies on alfalfa and other forages, alfalfa primarily. And so through our breeding efforts, we've got a breeding program, we do our own seed production, and then we also do the marketing, of course, through our commercial channels as well. And so it's been being part of that organization has been very wonderful because we've got a very wide, broad-based genetics that our research pulls from. And so it allows us to really bring forth some really good genetics to our customers.
Got it. And what kind of things do you do for the organization?
So what I do for the organization, I'm the National Sales and Marketing Manager. Mm-hmm. And I would say I've got a third hat in there too, which is product management.
Okay.
So for what I do for the company is I manage the sales team and develop the products or the programs and marketing things that we need to do to go to our dealer network. Secondarily, I'm in charge of leading the marketing efforts that we use both for our dealer network as far as sharing making sure we have the brand strategy out there so people can recognize our brand. And then my third hat, I would say, is the product management, which working with the research team to develop the product life cycles. We need products to come in to replace former products and so on. And then developing that strategy, it's all comprehensive at the end of the day, where the marketing side of things works with the production side and research to develop that story for those end customers and for your dealers to sell the product.
Yeah, I would imagine that sort of connection or relationship with product development is, and sales for that matter, but product development is probably really important, maybe more so than a typical marketing job, just being really keyed into to what's new and trends and new applications and things like that. I was thinking about it. Maybe if you could just educate our audience a bit and let us all know what is turf and forage.
Sure. So Alforex Seeds really doesn't deal with turf anymore, but okay. For the last 30 years, I've been involved with turf and forage, as well as sorghums and alfalfa primarily. But so what is alfalfa and forage and turf and forage as well? So turf is more relates to someone's lawn, right? Or a landscape, or around a commercial building or a golf course. On the forage side is a wide range of things, meaning it really helps to support the animal unit, right? It helps to supply forage for that dairy cow or that beef cow or that horses, sheep. I mean, you name the animal, those are you're looking at forages that will help fit that specific area. Because each one has a specific need and demand. And so the other part that's so unique is that through my years of experience I've seen on a national scale as well as a global scale, mm-hmm. what are the best fits for these products and where, because different parts of the country we'll use different species of forages, for an example.
Okay.
And what works well up in the northern part of the U.S. may not work the best down in the southern part of the U.S. because it's too hot or too humid and so on. So you got to realize what's out there, what's going to help those, the producer, that farmer, that grower to get the best benefit for their animals to make them most productive.
Got it. Got it. Yeah. You mentioned that you've been in the industry for about 30 years. I'm just curious, you know, what about the industry has kept you in it for as long as it, you know, you've been in it?
I would say that, you know, that's a great question for me. As I think about that, a couple things always come to mind is it's the people. I enjoy working with the farming. I grew up on a dairy farm in Northeast Wisconsin, and it's been in my blood throughout my career. And just being able to say I can help service and help support someone to help them benefit has been one thing. The other is just learning. I mean, there's a lot to learn about. There's a lot of different species when it comes to the forage grasses, alfalfas, that you can learn from. And also just the, it's not only about those species, but it's about how to plant them correctly in various areas. Some areas need irrigation, some areas don't. So there's always a learning process that goes, and you can relate some of those things back to other areas of the country.
Okay.
So you see it from a different perspective, is what I see it.
That's cool. What do you think some of the biggest changes, you've been in the industry a long time, some of the biggest changes you've seen in the industry?
Some of the biggest changes that I've seen is different uses of different species than what used to be. I mean, part of that is, that's one of it, part of it. And then the other part is just the change in the industry itself, the consolidation of people. There's farmers have gotten a lot bigger versus a lot of smaller farms.
Sure.
So things change within those dynamics as well.
Yeah. How has that affected the way you market and sell your business?
So how it impacts us really is we have to focus on fewer, larger people. However, they're more managing personnel. And so they do take an active role in what they do, but they may rely on another resource on their farm in order to make those best decisions for them. So you have to market it a little different. Plus, the farming community, the average age of the farm is still probably around in their mid-50s, mm-hmm. but you have to look at that next generation and the technologies in which to reach those younger folks is changing as well.
Right, definitely. Yep. I'm curious, what kind of problems do Alforex Seeds solve for farmers that maybe, you know, they're not able to get from other product offerings?
Well, for us, I would say a couple things. One other thing that I should repeat that, you know, that has changed a lot. In the past, we've always had a lot of extension agents that have been the driver in being that communication source or that information source for that grower.
Okay.
And so one of the unique things for us is that we've been over the last course of the last several years, COVID helped spur this on a little bit, was putting together some videos, for an example, training videos on how to utilize our products in various different ways. Could we do that otherwise? Sure, of course. But because of the average time frame that you're out in the field, you just have to do those things more readily.
Right. Do you find that manufacturers like Alforex need to bring value beyond just selling to help farmers, you know, who are operating in a fairly competitive and challenging environment?
Absolutely. It's a fast-paced world, right?
Yeah.
And so our what we're seeing is that the customers and dealers are demanding that we want to have someone to be at our disposal, that we can go and call on people, because as the farms have gotten bigger, they have forgotten a lot of things. And what I mean by it's not necessarily forgotten, but they're relying on other people to do certain things.
Okay.
And so you want to make sure that you're planting things correctly, you're getting it at the right soil depth, you know, putting them in at the right time of the year, harvesting it appropriately at the right time of the year as well to maximize that productivity. And so that's why they're relying on us as a company. And as, you know, that's why for us being an alfalfa and forage excellence, we're focused on those things versus being so, you know, involved with so many different things that you can't focus on certain areas.
Right. Yeah, so it sounds like you've got both the end consumer, the farmer, and the dealer distributors that you have to think about, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And so what specific things do you do to build awareness and acceptance and trial of your brand, you know, among those two distinct audiences?
For us, you know, we have to build the confidence of the dealer. And one of the things that we do in their sales team, so a couple things that we do, again, the training videos help for both.
Okay.
Secondarily, we have a couple research stations. And usually throughout the year, between May and September, we'll invite our dealers in and even growers to come in for doing tours. It gives them the confidence to see that, you know, it takes about 10 years to bring an alfalfa variety to market.
Oh, wow.
And so in doing so, most people, when they plant an alfalfa variety, they're only planting one variety. At a research station, you get to see hundreds, thousands of different varieties, and you can start seeing the differences amongst those varieties. So it's a unique way to do that.
Right.
And then I would say the third part for us is we're out there in trade shows. We're out there in both the developing the social media aspect of things too, as I mentioned earlier, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, trying to access and get access to those people by posting and getting responses back that way as well.
Because what kind of content do you find you're most often posting?
It will vary a lot, quite honestly, but we try to time it. We try to do things time it wise based off the time of the year where it's most meaningful to that end user. So if it's just prior to planting, if it's in season, there's certain topics that we try to, are there certain diseases that they need to be considering? Is it time to fertilize? Is it, you know, those kind of things.
Got it. So it's a lot of good value added stuff that helps both the, maybe the dealer, but more importantly, the farmer.
Yeah. Absolutely. And then asking them, you know, telling that grower, hey, contact us, contact your local dealer, you know, to take care of those things.
Yeah. I mean, I asked this question only because I just, on the other side of our business, just kicked off a relationship with a new agency that is involved in influencer marketing. And as I think about your business and you know, the farmer, you know, looking for trusted resources, do influencers, any idea if they play a role in your industry?
The influencers certainly do. You have to take and look for them. And some of them are very, you get very much out there. And but you also, no matter what you do, you always look for those influencers in the marketplace.
Right.
Because they're going to have a great impact for you. And hopefully if they've tried the product or if they've used the product and they've been successful with it, they'll share it with others.
Yeah, that's great. How important is branding to the farmer or the dealer, for that matter, in the forage space?
It's just as important as in any other space.
Okay.
Because at the end of the day, if they don't recognize a brand, they're more reluctant to try it unless they have a very strong relationship with that dealer that's out there.
Right.
And so if they can recognize it, they said, yes, I see that. I've heard about it. I want to try it. It's all very important.
Right. Okay. That's great. I saw that you, I think it was, I forget exactly, sometime last year, launched the Agriculture's Brighter Side video contest. I thought it was a pretty creative idea, pretty creative concept. And for our audience, you can see it. It is on their site. I'm just curious, how did that play and was it successful and are you continuing to use it?
Well, great question. You know, we had one of our sales reps at the time had come up with the idea because it was during a time frame when the market or the agricultural market was, let's call it a little bit on the depressed side.
Okay.
And, you know, that was at a time frame when you were seeing animals being slaughtered and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, farmers were getting depressed on it as well. So he said, hey, can we come up with this idea? Let's create a positive message for the agricultural industry. Mm-hmm. And so what we were doing was every other month running a video contest so people could down or upload videos of their of a positive message for the agricultural industry. And then at the end of that month or throughout that month, you could also tell your friends and they could go and vote for the their favorite videos. And so then there would be a prize. Was it a big prize? No, but there was a prize that people could do and they could have the bragging rights for that. Nice. So we did that for about a year. And so we did about six different months that we did that on. And we ended up stopping it because we weren't continuing to get the traction that we wanted to.
Okay.
But for the time that we did have, it was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It was really good.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, it was a very, very clever idea. So you carry sales in your title as well as marketing. Yeah, I'm curious how much of your world revolves around selling and how much of it is, you know, just pure marketing.
You know, in my world, I would say it's probably more, probably 60% selling, 40% marketing.
Okay.
You know, if I break it down, you have to have the greater influence in going and talking with the customers.
Yeah.
For me, working with my sales team to get out there and understanding what their needs are, what the growers' needs are.
Right.
So we can make sure that we facilitate and get done what's needed.
Yeah. Do you get insights from your salespeople that help sort of make your marketing more effective?
Absolutely. Well, from a couple of different standpoints. One is I always like to hear what's going on in the country. And so I enjoy riding out in the country as well with the sales team at the time. Couple reasons. One is if there's something that's happening out there that's really could be beneficial for us, I can relay that to our research team so they can start developing products to meet that market, knowing that, like I mentioned earlier, it takes 10 years to bring something to market.
Right.
And secondarily, then, it also helps me that I can hear things that the research team is working on that I can bring to market. And then also you can talk to the end users, you can talk to the dealers and say, if something like this were to come, what would you think about that?
Mm-hmm.
And then you start developing your story and your creative story. I shouldn't say creative story, but it is a story when you're marketing to influence other people. Right. And that's really what it's about.
How do you gather competitive intelligence? I'm just curious.
Well, the competitive intelligence, just like with anything, sometimes you'll be with a dealer or you'll be with a grower and they're saying, hey, what do you know about this particular product or that particular product? And you can pick up information about it.
Okay.
The other way that you can learn about it and it's become less is through university trials. The university, several universities put out public trials for alfalfa and other forage grasses and things too. So you can look at those on an annual basis to see how your product compares to someone else.
You're saying that doesn't happen as much as it used to?
Correct. There's not as many universities as there's not as many extension agents, forage extension agents as there used to be.
Okay.
And with that, they're not putting out as many trials.
Okay. Why is that?
Well, I think part of it is funding. Part of it is there's fewer alfalfa research programs remaining. There's really only, you know, four main breeding research programs left in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, with fewer trials out there, it's more challenging, put it that way.
Right. So talk to me a little bit about just getting back to the sales and marketing piece, you know, how well sales and marketing in general, not just at Alforex, but in general work together. And I ask that because in many other industries, too often find themselves at odds, you know, with differing goals and objectives. You find that to be the case in your industry? And if so, why or why not?
You know, what I tend to find is that the sales and marketing, on the sales side, they're always wanting something that's going to help enhance the sale, right?
Sure.
And on the marketing side, they always want things that are going to be show the benefits of our products, and hopefully that will generate interest by our sales team and others to do so. And so sometimes there is a rub, right? Because the sales reps may not have the product that they want to make the sale for their customer. And at the same time, the marketing people want information from the customer and their sales rep, and their sales rep might be a little bit more tight to offer that information. Or in our case, on the marketing side, we want those photos, so we don't have to, you know, the actual photos. We like to see those testimonials. We like to see those things. And sometimes it's not always easy to get those things as people think.
Sure.
You know, so that's where sometimes a rub can happen.
Yeah.
Because you want those, from a marketing standpoint, it's exciting to see, to get those live testimonials, to get those live photos, to get, you know, to make those videos that you want to make the most impactful, right?
Yeah. Are there like specific things that you develop from a marketing standpoint as like aids or assists for your salespeople when they're out selling?
Well, we've tended to start developing, of course, they always want tech sheets. We've tried, again, doing the video things, but we start using different programs that they can utilize in the field also, meaning that we can put the tools that they have in their toolbox, if I can say it that way, to go out there into the marketplace and put them in a spot that if you were a grower and you said, hey, can you send me that information? I'll ask you, can I have your email address? And I can send it to you from my phone, and it's to you almost instantly.
Okay.
So, which is something that's unique. Well, it may or may not be unique to everybody, but it's something that we've been able to utilize now over the course of the last couple of years.
Okay. That's great. Have you ever worked with any marketing agencies in the past?
We have. We actually work with, I'll try to explain this as best I can. Mm-hmm. We work with one agency that really has done a great job as far as strategy and tactics, and also doing the media buying and media placement for us.
Okay, got it.
And then the secondary one is one where we've used for about the last 15, 16 years. So we've had a long, long history. And that one is more that we've bought some of their time. And so we do their data. They do, if you want to call it, in-house day-to-day items where they help with the product guides, they help put ads together. They help do a lot of different things.
Okay.
More on the graphic side of things, more on the even putting price lists and things that we can send out through our dealer network on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
So there's two different distinct, you know, people that we work with. We don't have anybody in-house. That we've count on from that aspect of things.
Right. What advantages do you think having an agency gives a firm like yours, say, versus building an in-house team?
Well, I think they get from a strategy standpoint, I think they get a broader perspective,
mm-hmm.
because they're already involved with many other folks in the ag space. So they can kind of give you a broader perspective of what's really happening in the marketplace and what some of the new, maybe the new lingo, if you want to call it that, new verbiage that we need to consider and take into consideration with our marketing efforts.
Okay. How important is category experience with a marketing agency in your world?
That is extremely important.
Okay. That was kind of a softball question, but
it's really important because I will say that. So we have tried using an agency that was not as familiar with the agricultural aspect of things, and becomes more challenging. It becomes more frustrating.
Yeah,
because they're relying on everything that you have, versus we expect you to have some of these things, and we expect you to be able to understand and move forward. So the process takes a whole lot longer.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I mean, just having general dealer distributor experience, which a lot of agencies do, you know, in your world probably isn't enough. Yeah. I think because the industry that you operate in is so different than, you know, your typical dealer distributor world, I could see where category experience would be really important. Mm-hmm. So just a couple more questions. Any advice that you give to a marketer in and around your industry, you know, looking to bring a new agency on board?
You know, the advice that I would have is have a really good discussion with them and how familiar they are with, you know, with your the industry that you're into. Mm-hmm. Because if they're not, and you can start asking them some questions as far as, you know, to kind of get a feel from them, you'll get a pretty quick understanding. And although you have to also take and consider and say, okay, where is their area of expertise as well? Because mm-hmm. some areas, some marketing agencies may have a stronger emphasis in certain areas than others. And maybe you can utilize those things, but it's, you got to be very careful because the dollars you spend up front may take a whole lot more time and you can't get as much efficient or effective marketing done in a timely fashion.
Right. You mentioned earlier that one of the agencies was involved in media buying and planning, I assume. Mm-hmm. That category experience that you want that agency to have, does that benefit the agency when it comes to media planning and buying?
It does. Because at the end of the day, there's when we talk about media buying, we're not only talking about the paper, you know, the magazines that people see, but then also digital as well. And knowing and understanding on the digital side where those ads or what type of ads are going to make the most impact.
Right.
Also looking at, you know, if you're at a trade show and you're looking at certain types of media and marketing in those areas too, it's all very important.
Yeah.
And I think from my standpoint, having the right agency there to help and support those things are very important.
Yeah.
To be the most effective.
Yeah. So last question, if an agency were trying to knock down your door and attempting to win business from you, what advice would you give that agency?
Again, from my standpoint, I would say, come back with your plan. Tell me what are the things that you can do for me? What are the things that you expect from us as far as, are you expecting photos? What are the things you're expecting from us? And what kind of timelines is it going to be in order to complete some tasks? Give me an mm-hmm. idea of what you've done. And also, if they can share with you some highlights of other people that they worked with in your space,
right.
I think has been would be very important as well.
That's helpful. Yeah, that's great. I'm curious in the space that you play in, being as unique as it is, do you get a lot of agencies calling you or emailing you?
We've had a few. I wouldn't say had a lot, but we've had a few.
Okay.
And more of it's been related to, I'm going to say, social media.
Okay.
From that aspect more so than the buying of the other, you know, media space outlets.
Okay. And you may not be able to answer this, but any one call or email that really stood out to you from those agencies trying to break through to you?
Not necessarily. I would love to say, yes, I've got one, but I don't. So
no, that's okay. That's okay. That answer is telling, you know, the fact that nobody's able to really shout out and break through and get you to, you know, take notice. So maybe those agencies that work in your space need to work a little bit harder there.
Yep, absolutely.
So, well, cool. Well, listen, I really appreciate the time today. It was a great conversation, Doug. Was really looking forward to talking with you just because of the uniqueness of the category. You know, I grew up operating in the consumer packaged goods space, so, you know, selling things like toilet bowl cleaners and hand lotions, a little bit different than forage and alfalfa and all that good stuff that you're dealing with. So a lot of it is similar in the way you think about the brand and you think about your customer and all that kind of stuff, but certainly what you're selling is very different. So appreciate all the perspective, and again, appreciate your time, and wish you all the best throughout the rest of the week.
Well, thank you very much. I greatly appreciate the opportunity, Mark.
All right. Thanks so much.